Hello students, today the topic that we are going to discuss upon is thinking. We will define what is thinking and we will determine the types of thinking and how we use images into our thinking processes and how concepts help in our thinking. Now, can you tell me or can you trace back any time in your waking state or when you have been conscious, have you ever stopped thinking? I guess it is not possible for any of us. Even when we are sitting idle, we are doing nothing, we think about something or the other. We think maybe like what I will have after this or what I will do after this or where will I go. Thinking is a very continuous process and mind you, it is this ability of human mind that differentiates us from rest of the animal species. Now, a great person, that is Aristotle, philosopher, he has said human being is the thinking animal. And probably if I may be right to say, thinking is the ability or it is this ability of ours that has put us into the top of the human or the animal chain. Now, here thinking defines who we are, what we are as a species, and that has progressed our species in developing or being in the present situation that we are in. There are many people who have even attributed like what is the difference between the rest of the animal species and human beings, and they have found it is this concept of thinking that make us different from the rest of the animal species. René Descartes has even said that I think, therefore I am. My whole existence is dependent upon the nature of thinking that I do. So, I guess human being without thinking may not be existing. Thinking gives us direction. It gives meaning to our life. Even if we are not thinking in any direction, we still are thinking about nothing maybe or about something. So, this process that continuously goes on into our working or conscious memory help us to be where we are and what we are. So, thinking is a mental process characterized by the use of symbols and concepts to represent both the inner and outer reality. So, we use concepts and representations or we use symbols as such in the formation of our thinking. When we are thinking, we use a lot of symbols as in the form of words, marks, signs, drawings, objects that may have very specific meaning to us or that may have a general meaning. Like for example, when I am talking about the concept of thinking, we are all thinking from a psychological point of view, like how our mind is churning the ideas or thinking about logical explanation. So, here we are using the general symbols or you might have a very individualistic symbol that you might be using that are specifically known to you and nobody else. So, thinking process usually use symbols. For example, take like I want to go for a movie. Then I start thinking what kind of movie do I want to see? I want to see a horror movie or a comedy movie or a romantic movie. So, here whenever I am saying horror or comedy or romantic, I am immediately getting a picture or a symbol of that. That symbol may be a mental image of earlier horror movie or a comedy movie we have seen and we are basing our thinking process or decision from the earlier experiences. So, thinking uses symbols in the form of words, signs or drawings. Thinking also uses representations. Now, representations may be taken from a form of word, a visual image, a sound, a data, in any other sensory modality that is stored in our memory. So, for example, suppose I want to compose a song, I immediately start thinking or I immediately start recalling the other types of songs that I have heard earlier, so that maybe my song does not look like it, I have copied it from other songs. Or the kind of music piece I want to use. So, here I am using a sensory information or sensory representation to progress my present thinking. Now, as I said, thinking is a continuous process, it goes on continuously. Is it always necessary to have direction? No, it is not. As I told you, our thinking or the human mind is so complex or so well developed, highly developed, that many of the times we are thinking automatically. We are like, no, we do not even bother that, or we do not even ponder about the concept that, okay, we are thinking now, and it is such an automatic process for us. So, this automatic process might have some result in the end, or it might be just casual non-directional thinking that we are doing. But when we talk about thinking from academic perspective or from psychological perspective, we give more importance to focused or directed thinking. Why? Because they give more meaning, they give some kind of definite result, or they give some kind of shape to the thinking process that we are going through. Thinking can be also defined as a mental manipulation of symbols. Now, when we are using many things, when we are thinking, we tend to manipulate. We use the information in such a way that what we have learned, we are using that into our thinking process, but we might not be exactly using that information as we have learned it. We twist, we turn, we add information. For example, when we are talking about some event that we have gone across or come across, I can tell you for 100% surety, with 100% surety, that none of us can replicate the exact information that we have gone through. We always add our spices, as to say, or our extra information into the concept that we have gone through when we are narrating it to other people. So, here when we are using the symbols or representation into our thinking process, we tend to manipulate them. And it's not wrong to manipulate, it's just the adjustment. Manipulation here means the adjustment of the information according to the current context. It need not be a wrong manipulation. Now, thinking can also be defined as going beyond the information given. And the information that we have, if we don't go beyond that information and think about that particular information from other perspective or other angle, our society would never have developed. We would still have stuck to the same old formulas and methods. And it is because of our progressive thinking that we have gone beyond and we have developed beyond what we have learned in the basic senses. Thinking can also be a complex and high level skill earning. When we are learning some things, we are putting our thinking, our understanding into that, and then our thinking or our learning of that ability becomes more highly proficient. Thinking also fills up gaps in the evidences. So, okay, I have missed a movie, half of the movie, the beginning part of the movie, I will see the rest of the movie and use my thinking, okay, these might be, this is what might have happened in the first part, this is what might happen in the first, these things, and okay, fine, these are the end result. So, here in day to day activity, we might not be able to see everything that is happening around us. So, we put our thinking into that, we have tried to fill in the gap and complete the whole picture and understand the situation around us. And thinking can also help us when we are in doubt about how to act or want to behave or want to believe or what is our desire. What is our desire? What is my belief? When I am being forced upon or I am being, you know, brainwashed by somebody about any concept or any idea, I can put my own sensible thinking and accept or reject accordingly. I might be like, okay, fine, this person might be saying, but I need not follow it. My understanding about the concept is completely different. So, thinking not only progresses us intellectually, personally, psychologically, individually, as a whole in the society, it also helps us to understand the world around us. Now, the concept of thinking was very intriguing for the psychologists to understand, like, how this process, this complex process of thinking can be so comfortably or automatically done by human being. And they wanted to find out, like, how thinking has come into existence or what are the basic characteristics of thinking as a process. And in this view, we have to see some earlier viewpoints of the experts or the intellectuals that they have propagated towards understanding the concept of thinking. And early philosophical psychologists tended to look upon thinking as a faculty of mind or a primary mental activity along with intelligence or memory. So, how we have intelligence as such or how much amount of intelligence or whatever categorization of intelligence we have, how much memory we have, even in the same way you can categorize thinking. But to say so will be undermining the power of thinking. Thinking has no boundary, it can go to any extent. At the same position that I am sitting here and or talking to you, I can even float my thinking into the space I am flying over there. So, thinking has no boundary or no specific space, or you cannot categorize thinking into a specific category. Then you have a viewpoint from structuralist school of psychology. They consider thinking could be reduced to images, as perception could be reduced to sensation and emotion can be reduced to feelings. So, basically structuralist school of psychology, they said thinking is like, you know, when you imagine things, you are thinking. But there are people who cannot see, or there are people who cannot hear, but they can also think. So, here this viewpoint has also gone through some criticism, because other viewpoints have come up about the imageless thought processes, people who do not use images, who might be not be even able to see things, but they are able to think as efficiently as any other normal person. Then from other school of psychology, that is behaviorism, John Watson considered thinking as essentially a motor activity, especially involving the movement of the fine muscles in the throat and laryngeal region. So, when we are thinking, actually we are talking to ourselves, we are like okay, like that, internally we are talking to ourselves, and that is how, through motor activity, especially in the throat area, we are able to think. Well, it was again being criticized on the ground that thinking does not involve the activity of the throat, it actually involves the activity of the brain. These opinions about thinking have been, as I said, has been criticized on various grounds, and they have tried to find a source whereby actually you can trace back how thinking occurs. And however, the subsequent researchers have shown that brain is highly involved in the process of thinking, especially the cerebral cortex area and its associated parts are very highly active when the thinking process is going on in individual's mind. So, this is how you can see thinking can be traced back to the activities of the brain and may not be through the throat or to the images as such. So, as we are saying, we think, we might be thinking in varieties of ways, in various types of thinking that as possible can be the next major focus for us. So, here we focus specifically on the types of thinking that all of us can do or we involve automatically, and now we can name them specifically. So, the types of thinking that we might be using, some of them we can note now. The first one is autistic thinking. This type of thinking have very personal meaning to me and to a specific individual only. Especially you can say like dreams, for example, have very specific meaning and a very, very personal meaning. It has to be interpreted from the context and the experiences that the person has gone through by himself or herself. Or very specific, I am thinking about my favorite doll. So, that has a very specific emotional significance to me that cannot be related to anybody else. So, here when the thinking is only focused upon very personal meaningful objects or events or situation, those type of thinking are called as autistic thinking. Then the other type of thinking is called as focused thinking. It can also be called as directed thinking and convergent thinking. Focused thinking begins with a very clear starting and very clear ending with the main goal of getting a result or a solution. We start the thinking process with the aim that we have to find a solution for that particular situation. Usually, you can see in this kind of focused directed thinking in problem solving activities, or when you are given a task by your boss, you have to complete a task by this time. So, you have to put your thinking, you have to brainstorm and then find the task or solve the task and present it to the boss, or you have to study and write the exam, thereby you have to focus on the subject, study it, remember it, write the exam very well. So, here what is happening is your thinking is very focused and directed, and it is converged, it is focused onto one specific event, situation or problem to be solved. Then the other type of thinking is called as unfocused or non-directed thinking as such. Unfocused or non-directed thinking does not have any goal. They start anytime, they might stop anytime. They don't have any aim, they don't have any direction that okay, I have to think about. So, I'm just sitting and daydreaming, or I'm just sitting and listening to a lecture in the class, I'm getting bored. Immediately, I will start thinking, what will I have after the lecture, I want to eat something, or I will go out and watch a movie, or immediately I might change my thinking into, oh, I will buy something today, oh, okay, I will meet my friend. So, these kind of erratic thinking that does not have any direction, that is not actually going to be used in the future maybe, are called as unfocused or non-directed thinking. Then you have another form of thinking called as divergent thinking, and divergent thinking is a type of thinking whereby it might be focused or it might be unfocused. It is not necessary that divergent thinking has to be always focused, but at the same time it is not necessary that the divergent thinking has to be not focused. It is up to you how you are using the information from your environment and taking your thinking to a next level. Usually, divergent thinking means you start from a point of thinking and then go beyond the boundary, go beyond the actual learning or the experience that you have had and apply that thinking into multiple processes. This type of thinking usually can be seen in artistic endeavors or in scientific discoveries, whereby they might have started with a basic concept, idea, formula, method, whatever, but they apply it to a very creative new area of the concepts or thinking as such. Then the other form of thinking is called as meta-thinking or metacognition. It is thinking about thinking. Now, thinking about thinking, yes, thinking about thinking is also a type of thinking whereby, for example, you are trying to solve a problem of mathematics. Now, there are many formulas that you can use to solve that particular problem of mathematics. You have used one formula, but it has turned out to be wrong answer. Now, then again you go back like, okay, what was the formula I used, where did I go wrong, how could I go wrong, did I miss the step here, oh yes, I have missed the step here. So, the process that you are doing now about tracing back the method that you used to solve the problem is called as thinking about your thinking process. So, here you have applied your thinking process into activity and then you are analyzing it, you are understanding how you have done it or what you have done it is called as meta thinking or meta cognition. Then you have very simple form of thinking called as concrete thinking, whereby it involves the use of simple sensory images. The images that you have, so I have images of a movie, I have images of people, and I am thinking about my parents, I am thinking about my friends, they are called as concrete thinking. They are actually physically present, you are thinking about them in other situation, other context, but they are physically present for you in your life or environment. Then the other form of thinking is called as abstract thinking. It enables the individual to extend the information stored in their memory of past experiences beyond what is being analyzed and can be used in various forms. So, abstract thinking can be very much related to divergent thinking. Here, you need not stick to the concepts or the experiences or the physical sensory experiences that you have had, you can go beyond. I can write a story about dragons, I can write a story about, I can write a fairy tale story whereby I develop my own characters. So, here my thinking is not restricted to the physical experiences that I have had, I can go beyond. And these are the kind of thinking that are usually used by creative people or people who go beyond the normal experiences. Now, as we have earlier discussed about thinking using symbols and representations, the symbols usually can be seen that it is used or represented in the form of images. So, it becomes quite important for us to understand the role of images in the process of thinking. Now, if I ask you, can you guide me how to go from your college to your home? Can you just trace the direction and tell me? You immediately start thinking about the direction, the ways, the turns, and then you tell me how I should go. I should take left turn, I should go straight, then I should take a U-turn, I will see a bakery or a movie theater, and just next to the movie theater there is an apartment, there I stay. So, here when you are narrating the directions for your place to go or visit, you might be using images, you might be using mental pictures. So, when we are thinking, many of us, it is not necessary every one of us, but many of us tend to use images into our thinking process. Now, images are mental representation of what we have experienced or learned. They are not the exact replication of the experiences or the learning things that we have had. Mental images, if I ask you to imagine the elephant in the size of the rat, you can immediately do that, your mind can do that. Or if I ask you to focus only on the tail of the elephant or the trunk of the elephant, your mind can actually think about only the trunk, it will enlarge the trunk and only focus on that. This very ability shows that images in thinking are representations, are manipulation of the experiences that we have had. When I ask you to think about snow, in daytime it would look white, in night time it would look grayish, but you still know it is white in color. So, not only how we have seen the experiences or the images, we also can represent it accordingly and manipulate it, change it. So, immediately if I say it is night, you are standing on the snow, but somebody has put on light. Immediately you can visualize the whole area getting brightened up. So, you are able to manipulate the images in your thought processes, and this, it is this manipulation of images that leads to creating new thinking concepts, ideas and information. When we use images to think, they are not usually complete pictures in the head. Images are abstractions of certain features from previous experiences. So, as I asked you, if I can say just think about Taj Mahal. So, you would start thinking about Taj Mahal, but is it the complete picture that you are getting in the mind? It is the abstraction of the picture or the photo, or when you have visited the place, you abstract the information, and remember Taj Mahal, the first thing comes is white, white marble, then maybe you will remember the dome and the four minarets. So, here the abstraction of the important features of the images that you have stored earlier in your memory helps in your thinking process. So, it is just the generalization and abstraction process that helps you to forward your thinking, and it is not exactly the same replication as I have told earlier in the thinking process. Mental imagery may improve other types of skills as such. It can also help you to imagine and improve your skills upon. How is that possible? Well, it is very famously done by chess players. When they are playing a game of chess, they can actually foresee the kind of moves that their counterparts would make in the future of the game. And this is happening through the mental imagery process that they are using in their thinking ability. When they are playing the chess coins, they can make out or attribute what the counterpart is going to do next. And that is how, before the counterpart has actually put the chess coin, they forward or they think that, okay, next my step would be this. And this is how you can improve your skill. Many of the musicians also, they say, they before they make song or before they make the music piece, they tend to visualize the music piece in their mind in the form of images. And that is how first visualization of the lyrics or the music piece help them or forward them or in a way influence them to develop the piece in actual physical nature. So, imagery can not only help you to develop or progress your thinking process, it can actually develop your skills also. Now, as we have seen, images are being very useful in the process of thinking, so is the use of concepts in thinking. Concepts are the mental shortcuts or categories or mental boxes that help us to store large and varied amount of information that we are bombarded into our daily, everyday activities or life. Now, when we form concepts, for example, I have a concept of tree. Now, when I say tree, if we remember, it's a big, huge, green, with big bark, a kind of object or a entity that gives us oxygen, most of them, and that gives us shelter, and it is helpful for our environment. Now, if I ask you to name varieties of trees, then you can list out. There are thousands and thousands of varieties of trees which you can name. But to remember the tree as such, you have formed a concept of tree, and that concept of tree is not mixed with the concept of books. Books are separate. Books are to be read, they are to be studied, they are to be relegated and understood as such. So, here when we are forming concepts, we categorize the experiences that we have had into separate categories, and thinking uses that very concept in its process. When we are thinking about music, we only take the concept of music. When we are thinking about food, we only take the concept of food. In food, again, savory item, sweet desserts or whatever. When we are thinking about movies, we only think about the concept of movies, horror, comedy, romantic, whatever. When we are thinking about politics, we only take the concepts of politics, the disciplines of politics. When we are thinking about men, we are only taking the attributes or characteristics or concepts of men. When we are thinking about women, we are only taking the attributes, characteristics of a woman. So, here concept is heavily a determining factor in the process of thinking. When we think, we use a lot of, or we are heavily, our thinking process is heavily dependent upon the uses of concept. Undirected, unfocused thinking also uses concepts. So, my thinking has no goal, no direction. I want to make this, I want to make an aeroplane, but I don't have the funding, I'm just thinking, just for the sake of thinking. There also I'm using the concept of aeroplane, though it might not be actually resulting in making me an aeroplane as such. So, here whether it is focused or non-focused or directed or divergent thinking, each aspect of thinking is determined by the type of concepts that we have formed. Now, if I say, let us think about a pen that can write the exams for us, okay, that is a very, very good, interesting concept. All the students would be very happy to know that there is a pen that would read the question and write the answer by itself, and we need not work hard and study or whatever. So, there the idea is good, but do we have the knowledge, do we have the idea or concept of using the technology in making that pen? No. So, we have to learn that concept, we have to learn that technology, and once we learn that technology, we have the concept about that technology, then we can think about later on in making a pen that can write by itself and that can answer the paper by itself. So, here we can see thinking is being heavily influenced by both images and concepts that we come across into our day to day learning experiences as such. So, thinking, whether we are directed, whether we are focused, whether we are unfocused, whether we are using whatever types of thinking, whether we are actually putting our effort into the thinking process or not, we cannot avoid thinking. Thinking is a very process, very automatic process, very part of our living being as such, and maybe without thinking, without the ability of thinking, as Descartes has said, we might not be even able to exist. So, go ahead and think your way out. Most of the thinking, I hope they turn out to be fruitful.